it's turned upside down, and you know you gotta start over somehow. There's a will, there's a way.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. Worlds Apart is a program that looks to investigate how racism, ethnocentrism, cultural, and social divide manifest themselves within our society. Worlds Apart will consider the historic, scientific, cultural, and social factors that perpetuate these issues. Additionally, Worlds Apart was created to serve as a constructive dialogue piece around issues related to race and race relations, a topic that most people aren't comfortable broaching. We're going into our ninth year now, and we're so thankful for all the major corporations that have supported the program over the years. We're looking to have a very aggressive agenda for this year, where we'll be planning to visit Columbia University to the Teachers College. We're making plans for a tour of Africa, Benin, Ghana, and South Africa, and we're also looking to go to Brazil. So 2006 is going to be a very busy year for our program, but at this time I'd like to introduce a guest that I just recently met, although we grew up in the same neck of the woods, but I guess God has a way of bringing paths together. But at this time I'd like to introduce the Honorable District Judge Robert Jennings. Welcome to Worlds Apart.
Thank you, sir. Pleasure. Yes. Thank you for having me.
Yes, give us some background about yourself and what you do, sir.
Well, I'm 55 years old. I'm born and raised in Uptown Harrisburg. I graduated from William Penn in 1968. I really like to give credit to the Harrisburg School District. I'm a product of the Harrisburg School District. Of course, it's a different time than it is now. Mm-hmm. I've been involved in the community practically all of my adult life, one way or the other. I one time belonged to the Harrisburg Uptown Neighbors Together. I've been coaching Harrisburg Packer midget football for the last 14 years. I'm one who believes that you can't talk the talk, you have to walk the walk. Right. And in order to walk the walk, you have to get into the heart of the community to try to figure out what needs to be done, then you have to do it. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of lip professors. I like to consider myself an action professor. I have been wanting to become a magisterial district judge for quite some time, for a lot of obvious reasons. And one of the main reasons I wanted to become a district judge, because I feel as though I have the heart of the community. I know what's going on. I understand people. And I think that's important with a district judge.
Let me ask you this, though. When you say you have the heart of the community, what does that really mean, though? I hear people say, I have the heart of the community. What does that say how you understand the community?
Well, for me, when I say I have the heart of the community, people for years have always walked up to me and have poured their heart out to me about different issues that needed to be changed. They just didn't know how to go about it. And so I'm one that tries to figure out a way to facilitate that change that needs to be done. Mm-hmm. They say the kids don't have anything to do, so I became involved in midget football. And we tried to get out there and coach kids and teach them it's another way of life besides gang banging and being a thug. Wow. And one of the things I teach the guys when we're in summer practice and it's hot and sweaty, that anything that's worth having is worth working for. You got to put a lot into it. Anybody can thug. Mm-hmm. You can be illiterate, first grade education. You can be ignorant. Anybody can be a thug. Anybody cannot become a productive individual. And that's what we need in our communities, productive individuals.
Well, let me ask you this, and to sort of be devil's advocate, you mentioned the term thug and that type of dynamic. But do you think that maybe some of the social conditions sort of in some ways exacerbate tend to serve as a catalyst for people to enter into that type of life? Or do you think it's just no excuse for no one to do that? You have just as much opportunity as everyone else. How would you respond to that?
Well, I think both sides are at extreme. I look at it as everybody has a chance, but you have to be told that. You see, I came along with a time when I had a couple of dads, a couple of moms, And that all made it better. See, today, with this generation that's in today, first of all, the younger generation, they don't want anybody telling their kids anything. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So therefore, the parents don't have any help. You know, they had single parents when I came along.
Right.
But they had help because you had the lady down the street, the gentleman across the street. And if they saw you getting out of line, they told you that. So you had help. Now they don't have help. Some of these kids don't have a chance. Mm-hmm. They never, ever had a chance. If you come out of a house where your mom's been in and out of jail, your dad's been in and out of jail, your uncles is in and out of jail, all the traffic coming in and out of your house is people with parole officers, well, you don't know anything else. Unless the Lord just blesses you to rise up among that muck and mire and stand up, mm-hmm, and be a productive individual, you know nothing else. Mm-hmm. And some of these kids need to be showed another side. Mm-hmm.
So you, to some extent, you understand the conditions that in some ways create this kind of an outcome. Not that you're saying it's okay, but you do, you are sensitive to the fact. And what do you say then to people? How do they break that cycle? How do they rise above, as you said, coming out of the muck and the mire, how do they rise above that, seeing they don't have necessarily the same kind of support systems as we had years ago?
Right. Well, this is why we all have to sort of volunteer. We have to find something to do. You have to find a way to volunteer in church. You have to find a way to volunteer in some social or club organization. We have to become those kids' parents, whether we like it or not. The problem is you might find a child that doesn't want to listen to you. But you have to ignore that child and go to the child that you think you can reach and try. You may not. You may not be successful in that venture. However, you have to try. Because when you go to bed at night and you get up in the morning and brush your teeth, you want to say, I tried. I think I did the right thing.
So do you think a lot of what's driven you is that you wanted to make a difference after hearing, to some extent, the maybe you could say hopelessness or some of the frustration that people had within the community you grew up in?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think you got to show some kids hope. You got to show them love. Nobody loves the kids anymore. And I tell people, I'm big on corporal punishment. But to use corporal punishment on a child and not love them, that's abuse. That's abuse.
And we can talk about that when we come back. But if you're just now tuning in, I have with me as my guest, District Judge Mr. Robert Jennings, and he's my guest. Robert Jennings III, I believe, isn't that correct?
That's correct.
All right, Robert Jennings III, so get it right. He's my guest, and we're talking specifically about his involvement within the community and ultimately what led him to become a district judge and some of his thoughts in terms of solutions as it relates to a lot of the issues that impact not only minority communities, but if it impacts one community, it ultimately impacts others and how we can try to best go about addressing these issues. So we'd like to pause some words from our sponsors. Stay tuned. We'll be right back to Worlds Apart.
Support for Worlds Apart is provided in part by York Foundation, a community foundation, and Susquehanna Falls Craft Company.
Through the Community Care Fund, United Way supports programs like the American Red Cross CPR training that saved Vilma Thompson's life.
I just say what a wonderful thing it is to be alive and know that you owe your life to somebody because they took the time to learn how to save a life.
I'd like to thank the community. I'd like to thank everyone that donates to the United Way. And I would like to ask those that don't donate to the United Way to find it in their heart to do so.
Your sweet getaway. Visit HersheyPA.com.
Mainly the reason I chose Central Penn is because it gives you a small individual experience so each and every teacher knows who you are.
The professors know you one-on-one, not by a number, your name.
Not only do we have textbooks to learn from, but we're getting people who are actually in the field.
When they teach you what they have learned, it's actually really good because you know, it's like, wow, this person knows what they're talking about.
I have the drive and the motivation to succeed, and I think the teachers help show me that in myself.
Faculty dedicated to your future success.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by the Bon Ton.
Whether it's in the city, the country, or somewhere in between, owning your own home means something special, something comfortable and secure. No wonder it's a dream we all share. We're the Pennsylvania Housing Finance Agency, working to put safe, affordable housing within reach of every citizen. Find out more by visiting phfa.org, because it doesn't have to be just a dream.
Back to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just now tuning in, I have with me, my guest, the Honorable District Judge, Mr. Robert Jennings III, and he's my guest. And we're just talking about his perspective on community service and how he's tried to make a difference as a district magistrate within the community. And when we were off break, we were sort of talking about bling bling, and I'm looking at you, and you bling bling down with your watch and your rings and your chain there. Talk about that a little bit, Judge.
Well, I'm basically an old school judge.
Okay.
I'm out of that 60 areas, you
okay,
know,
right.
The rings and the cufflinks
and all that kind of stuff.
But one of the things it shows young people that, hey, you can have these things if that's what you want, mm-hmm. and you don't have to sell drugs.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and one thing, you know, I say to them once in a while, and they'll say something, well, Judge, I like your shoes, I like this. I say, well, thank you very much. But, you know, you can have the same thing, and you don't have to sell dope.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's important that young people, they only think that the only way that you can handle a lot of money is if you sell drugs. Now, I definitely don't handle a lot of money, so let's get that cleared here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, okay. I'm just a working stiff.
Right,
you understand
right.
what I mean? But we all have a tendency to gravitate to which that we like. Mm-hmm. A lot of the jewelry and stuff that I wear, in fact, 95% of it was my father's. He's deceased and gone, and usually when I'm dressed, I wear something of my father's every day. But we have to get out, and we have to try to talk to these young people. That's what I want to do, because I'm interested in doing something just instead of just locking them up.
Right.
Now, understand, make no mistake about it. I don't have any problem locking you up mm-hmm. if that's what it calls for. But I would just as soon come out on a Sunday when I could be home watching the game, or a Saturday when I can be relaxing or eating at a nice restaurant. I just as soon make the sacrifice, like I am today, to drive all the way over here and sit down and talk. And hopefully one of the little guys or one of the little ladies will see this and be encouraged and say, you know, I can do that plus a whole lot more. Because I don't think I've achieved anything great. I'd like all the young people to come in contact with me to surpass what I'm doing. Because we have, it's the only thing to do. You know, people take a lot of solutions to the problems that don't work. It's like moving to the suburbs. I'm a city boy, born and raised. You can move to the suburbs all you want. You can change school districts. But I'm telling you, sooner or later, that same crime, that same apathy is coming out to where you live at. It's going to affect
and
you.
And the research is bearing you out. I'm looking to be hired by a suburban school district to address some of those very same issues of black-white achievement. As a matter
right.
of fact, some of their scores are dropping. And I'm not saying that students that are moving from the inner city into some of the suburban areas can't learn, but the rigors in terms of their academic preparation isn't quite up to speed. And as a result, some of these suburban school districts now are feeling the results as far as the test scores. And some of the crime that tends to be stereotypic to the urban communities, really proportionally, there's just much of that kind of crime going out there, as quiet as a cat when you talk about drug trafficking
yeah.
and a lot of other things.
Oh, absolutely,
respond to that.
Because all you have to do is come to my courtroom any Tuesday and you can see it. I mean, I get them from Mifflin County, mm-hmm. Snyder County, Juniata County, mm-hmm. Perry County, Schuylkill County, Lancaster County, Cumberland County.
Mm-hmm.
It's all over.
Mm-hmm.
I had people from I don't even know where the places are,
mm-hmm.
but they're coming in town to buy drugs. Mm-hmm. It's the drug problem initially probably was well advertised in the city of Harrisburg,
mm-hmm.
but it has exceeded city boundaries
mm-hmm.
by hours.
Mm-hmm.
Believe me,
right?
And it's just amazing. And I mean, some of the people that you see, they're in bad shape.
Mm-hmm.
Bad shape. It's a world problem.
Right, and it crosses racial or ethnic
boundaries.
Oh,
race has nothing to do with it. I mean...
Although we're disproportionately impacted by the criminal justice system, would you say?
Well...
Or respond to that, or if you can't, then I understand in terms of...
Well, yeah. And I think it's because...
I know we are. I say that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, absolutely. I mean, I'm a judge, and I make no bones about some things I can't comment on.
Right.
But the truth is the truth.
Right.
Whether I comment on it or not.
The research is out there, right.
Sure. I personally think the inner city is targeted for that type of thing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But like I said, man, you know, you see it from everywhere. I mean, I've even walked out my door and see the guy in a pickup truck with an older lady in a rocking chair in the back, like Granny on the Beverly Hill Hillbillies.
Mm.
Asking me where he can purchase drugs. Now, that's straight up truth.
Okay.
So, whoever don't like it,
mm-hmm,
but that's the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, I'm not trying to throw stones at people
that
live
group,
in rural America.
But
it's a drug problem.
Rural
America,
innocent, groups,
correct.
It's everybody.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. It's everywhere and everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And they talk about Osama bin Laden, but truthfully, Mr. Wade, sir, if we don't get a hold of this drug situation,
here.
Mm-hmm. You don't have to worry about Osama. He's going to be able to walk into this country and take it over
mm-hmm.
if we don't get a hold of the drug problem that we have here. Mm-hmm. And we all have to do something.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm urging everybody within the sound of your voice, because
mm-hmm.
this is your program,
right.
sir, to find something to do to try to help the problem. I don't care if it's boys and girls clubs. I don't care if it's big sisters, big brothers. I don't care if it's the Y. I don't care what it is. Women's shelters, men's shelters. You got to find something to do to try to help the problem.
Well, I'm going to ask this question. We'll have a little time to answer it now, and then we can go into our final set. But have you been able to create any networks with corporations? Because I know that there's this big issue of people that, you know, come out of jail with felonies. Most corporations aren't going to hire. Have you, as a judge, been able to try to call and say, look, I know this individual. Yeah, he got caught up this blah, blah, blah. But I think he would be productive in terms of needing a job. Are you looking to create those kinds of networks, or is it out of your capacity as a judge to do those types of things in terms of networking?
Well, I would love to see something like that take place, sir. But I don't think by law I'm allowed to do that.
Okay.
I would like to, give all the accolades to organization. Mm-hmm. Or you see, I think. Personally, I think that's where the churches should come in.
Right, and that's what we're going to talk about.
The churches and your civic groups, they have to be the mom and dads. I mean, you can no longer go in there and worship and come on. Mm-hmm. The churches and your civic groups, folks, you got to be the moms and dads. Because if you don't, you're either the mom and dad today or you're the victim tomorrow. Mm-hmm. It's that simple. You know, you're either part of the problem or part of the solution. You can't stay neutral. Mm-hmm. There's no fence there.
Okay. Well, if you're just not tuning in, I have with me my guest, a district judge, Mr. Robert Jennings III, and he's my guest. And we're just talking about various aspects of his work as a judge and his volunteerism in the community and what he sees as potential solutions in terms of how do we address these kinds of dynamics. What we'd like to do now is pause some words from my sponsor. Stay tuned. We'll be right back to Worlds Apart.
Hershey Foods Corporation supports the efforts of Worlds Apart in promoting the understanding, acceptance, and value of diversity.
Want words like skilled, expert, and nationally recognized. When you need to have confidence as well as courage. When it's your health, your body, your life. We have the finest team of specialists waiting to help. WellSpan Health, the region's most comprehensive healthcare system. WellSpan Health, for the journey that is life.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by the Bonton Stores Foundation. Worlds Apart is underwritten by Graham Packaging Company. Graham Packaging Company values diversity in the workplace as a competitive advantage.
Hi, I'm Bob Darr, Vice President of Harrisburg Toyota Chrysler Jeep. We're proud to be corporate sponsors of Worlds Apart. And if you're ever in the market for a new Toyota, Chrysler Jeep, or a used car, come on down and see us.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by Wolf Printing.
Why do you and me have to be?
Behold me, we felt evidence.
I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just now tuning in, I have with me the Honorable District Judge Robert Jennings III, and he's my guest. And we're talking about different aspects of community activism, his role, how he sees himself in terms of how he can best support and be a part of being the solutions within a lot of the community activities that go on with in the area that he lives. But let's talk about, you know, I've had judges on my program, and some judges have concerns about some level of judicial discretion. I'm sure you understand the concept about, you know, you have laws that are set in place and it doesn't give and the judges very little latitude in terms of maybe some of the things that they would like to do. Talk about that briefly, if you would, please.
Well, basically, it just depends on what law has been broken and what a person's been charged. I, as a magistrate district judge, I can accept a misdemeanor 3 plea if somebody wants to plead guilty. If the attorney's in agreement with it, they understand what they're pleading to, the Commonwealth is in agreement to it, then I can accept a misdemeanor three plea. The problem is when I accept those pleas, I'm interested in people getting help. Mm-hmm. I work real strong and closely with a county organization called Pre-Trial Services, and I'm interested in getting people help. I mean, let's face it, the jails are just bulging over. So apparently locking them up is not the only solution. Again, as I said earlier, I don't have any problem locking them up if that's what it calls for. But I would just as soon see the addict try to get some kind of help. And sometimes they get some help in jail now. Depending on the situation, how many times a person comes, you know, I can't give you any hard and fast rules.
Right, sure.
But I can tell you this. I, as a magisterial district judge, try to do everything I can to try to see that the people get the proper help that they need. A lot of people don't understand. I'm basically a neighborhood judge. Now, make no mistake about it, I'm part of the judiciary. In fact, I'm what they call a minor judiciary. I have ethics, I have guidelines, and I will follow them to the nine. But also, in the areas where I have some discretion, if I can help somebody by getting somebody some help instead of just locking them up, I try.
Would you like more latitude, though, or would you, are you generally
comfortable? I would. I would. I'd like a lot more latitude.
Oh, you would?
I would. But I imagine that would have to be something that's done
through the
by statute.
Yeah, through the legislature, right.
Or even if they could just give my president judge the permission so he can give me the permission. By the way, I have a great president judge. Judge Richard Lewis is an excellent president judge, and I really admire him, and I look up to just the way he handles
this
things.
Is not a paid commercial, is it?
No. And I'm not a brown noser.
That'd be kind of tough if you were a brown noser.
That's right. I don't. It's just straight up respect. I don't kiss up to nobody.
Right, right.
Now that's caused me some problems in the past. But that's just the way I am. I don't. I just try to be a straight up man about.
Talk about, was it called direct file or some kind of filing process? That's
direct
dealing
file.
With
it? Yeah, we were talking about that that time. But a lot of young people, they're making a mistake. 14, I think you have to at least be 14 years old. If you commit an adult crime, they can what they call direct file. Take a 14-year-old, charge him, incarcerate him in an adult correctional facility like 501, and they also can send him to a state correctional institution. You'd be surprised some of the institutions that have 14 and 15-year-olds.
And you don't have to comment on it, but why would you want to send a child or a teenager in a kind of environment like that, as pernicious as it is?
Well, it's because you have young people committing very violent crimes.
I understand. But they're still young
people. Let me just say this, not as a judge. When I was a constable one time.
Okay.
And one of the things I did at that time, they no longer let the constables do. If a family member died in the immediate family, mother, brother, sister, grandpa, granddad, we would go to the penitentiary and get the prisoner and take him to the funeral and take him back. The family paid us for that. Well, I was up there one time, and I overheard the guards talking about, you got guys up here 15 years old doing triple life. They can't even come up for parole until they're 75 years old. That's part of that direct file.
How about the Black and Latino community? You have concerns there, or in terms of how they're working together or not working together? Briefly talk about that.
Well, I would personally like to see the Black community and the Latino community work together. They seem to have a lot of the same problems, and they seem to end up with the same woes. And when I'm on night court, I see a big mixture of Black and Latinos coming through there to be arraigned. And the same way with them. They're going to have to work together. We're going to have to get some leaders. We're going to have to get some Latinos to go out and talk to some Latinos.
Churches are going to take a more active role.
Churches, you got a lot of Latinos are Catholic, but you have a lot of Latino Pentecostal churches.
That's true. Right.
And they're going to have to get out. They're going to take a lot of role. They're going to have to be the parents. The churches are going to have to be mom and dad. They may not like it, but that's where it's going to be. And one of the mothers in the church is going to have to be the mother, the grandmother, the aunts. We're going to have to make drastic moves. We're going to have to get up off of our behinds and do something. Now, I'm all with praying. I don't want nobody to say he said they ain't. That's not what I'm saying, church. God knows I love church people. Praise the Lord. But we got to get up off our knees.
Right.
And after we get done praying, yeah, now I'm for getting down on my knees. By the way, I got bad knees.
Okay.
But I'm going to get down on them anyway.
Okay. We don't have much time. If somebody want to get in contact with you, how could they do that?
Give me a call at 233-3599, 233-3599, or send a phone book under Magisterial District Judge Robert Jennings III.
And you're available for public speaking?
I'd love to come out and talk to the kids, or you got adults that's having a problem with kids, come talk to me. Let's see if we can work something out. Let's see if we can help somebody.
Okay. Well, Judge Jennings, thank you so much for
coming. More than a pleasure, sir. Thank you.
And I understand that you're quite a fan of Worlds Apart. I heard you watch the program several times.
Oh, absolutely, sir. Right, I'm honored to be here. Can I get autographs?
All right, then. Well, thank you so much. For Worlds Apart, I'm Brian Wade. Good evening, good night, and God bless.
The African American History Minute. Today's trivia question is, who was the first African American woman to fly in space? Today's featured African-American is Dr. Julian Earls. Director of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration's Glenn Research Center in Cleveland, Ohio. As director, Dr. Earls is responsible for planning, organizing, and directing the activities required to accomplish the missions assigned to the center.
When you learn the history of a people, you gain greater respect for those people. When you learn your own history, you gain greater respect for yourself.
He was torchbearer for the 2002 Winter Olympics and has twice received NASA medals for exceptional achievement and leadership.
If the history books told the truth about Black history, we would not need Black History Month.
Who was the first African-American woman to fly in space? The answer is Mae Jemison. Until next time, remember, we're standing on the shoulders of giants.
Ooh, there's nothing quite as two people full of hate. We'll